So it is a pleasure to have Eli Pomoni that will talk about exact results.
I will be in four dimensions. I will not have n equal to 1 supersymmetry. And I will talk about something called class escape. And yes, the goal is to have exact results and maybe a relation with 2D CFD. And okay, before I start, I want to thank the organizers. I don't know what I did to deserve this very nice treatment. I thought that Aspen was the best conference I have ever been, but this is actually much better. It really sets the standards very high.
Until your next conference, where you will say the same
thing. I didn't have to say this. So, first of all, this is work with Joanna Coleman, Masato Taki, Futoshi Yagi, and Vladimir Mitev. And there are also a few other papers that Tom is here, is my student, and we are working on a project related to this with him. And I will also say some things as I go. My motivation for this work, I have to say this is the last year of my life. I am really doing only SK. I am very obsessed with it. So my motivation for this... was the success story for theories with n equal to 2 supersymmetry. I will actually make, you know, how you make the list of your favorite 10 movies. Something very similar will be here. The first access we ever had to exact results was with the work of Seiberg and Witten, who told us how to calculate n equal to 2 theories in the IR. Then the next step came from Nekrasov, who told us how to calculate the instant of partition functions for theories with n equal to 2 supersymmetry. And in fact, he was able to produce and give a microscopic derivation of Seiberg and Witten. Then the years are passing, and we go to Tesco. And I'm already doing my PhD, and I remember his talk at Stony Brook. This is when we really go to the UV, and we can see that you can put the n equal to 2 theories on a four-sphere, and the path integral localizes. And you can calculate now observables in the UV, exactly. And then, I have to say, first of all, that while going through this list, there were very important the fact that we have string theory, or M theory, or even now F theory constructions of our favorite n equal to 2 theories. And these are really give us a geometric understanding of what we are doing before we even start calculating. Because sometimes the formulas might be very ugly, but if you have an edge geometric picture, you are not so much afraid. Go for it. And then we go to 2009 and to Gaiotto, who basically began by playing with Seiberg-Witten curves, and he told us that we can obtain a very large class of n equal to 2 theories by compactifying the 2,0 on surfaces, and we had Jacques, he gave us a review on class S. So class S is going to the scale will be very similar to this. And immediately after Gaiotto, Aldai, Gaiotto, and Tachikawa told us that there is a way to relate the Peston partition function to some 2D CFT correlator. And again, also the same year, and I am very lucky to be in this paper, we learned that the 4D superconformal index is equal to another correlator, but now of a 2D topological free theory. And already, with all these 2009 results, we started realizing that there is a way to have 2D for the relations. To have some way to capture some four-dimensional n equal to 2 observables by much simpler 2D calculations. So this is the motivation. And having this table, I want to go here and ask what we can do for theories with only n equal to 1 supersimilar. So, of course, my generation is twisted. We all know very well how to do the index, and maybe it's harder to go up. So, coming from my generation, I have to say that the index, we have it. It was born to be n equal to 1. So for your favorite n equal to 1 theory, you can just write down the index, and you can ask such questions, and in a minute I will say something about that. But then we have to untwist our education and to go to the past, and to remember that already immediately after the original Seiberg and Witten paper in the Ligeiro, together with Seiberg, they taught us that we can actually calculate curves for n equal to 1 theories as long as the n equal to 1 theories have an abelian Coulomb branch. So, and also, referring back to the M-theory constructions, Witten also, immediately after his original paper where he told us how to calculate curves from M-theory, he wrote a second paper where he gave an example for an n equal to 1 theory. So, this is the tool with which I start. Let me a little bit say something negative, so that to also give motivation to undo. There is no localization for now. And I really want to write here for now, because we are working on it. After this thing that you will see today, hopefully you will also believe that one should really try. But I want to say why not for now. Because something scary happened. So, Komagorsky, Gomis, and Yakovich, they wrote a very beautiful paper, but they said the partition function as a function of the coupling constants on S4 for n equal to 1 theories is plagued with scheme ambiguities. And I guess this immediately put off many people, and they didn't even want to try. Thankfully, the same year, there was another paper by Nikolai Bomber, Ferrietta Elvang, Kohl, Olson, Buffy, who in fact said that fine, you don't have to make sense of the full partition function. You can in fact take derivatives. And for the case they studied, 3 was the number of derivatives they had to take with respect of mass deformations of the theory. And then the partition function or the free energy will have a part that is universal. So
if you introduce some deformation in M, you take a derivative and you take M to 0.
Yes. And you can also keep M, because we also want to know what happens also with M.
So this is roughly a three-point correlation function of the Grelman operator corresponding to the mass deformation.
And is this like a similar argument of why, if you compute, for instance, you have a divergent quantity, you put it off shell, you regulate, but then when you take two derivatives, let's say, the piece is always...
Yes, but of course the way they do this job is they study counter terms in supergravity, blah, 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 blah.
This is for finite M, right?
What is finite?
Is this universal function of M, or is this universal...
Of G's and M.
I see, for a minute.
So now, having said these things, it is important for us to try to select the n equal to 1 theories with which we will work in a little bit smart way. So in this direction, first of all, I want to say that I want to pick conformal n equal to 1 theories. So that there is a conformal manifold, then I can then deform it with the relevant operators and all that. And of course, ABCFT, from the beginning, it gave us a very clear route to conformal theories with n equal to 1 supersymmetry. And the important example is orbifold. And this is the example I will think about today. Of course, one can think of other things. And I really believe that some of the things that I will say today, one can actually really push to the better deform n equal to 4, okay, to your favorite n equal to 1, as long as there is an unlimited long branch. And then, the modern way to all that is to begin with your 6D, 1,0, which by now I think we hope it's classified, and put it on the Riemann surface. The same way that you ought to put the 2,0 and work from there. Now, the original paper that motivated me for all of this work was the paper by Gagliotto and Razamat. Where they invented this class SK. Of course, I have to say, I mean, it's not really in some sense their invention. People knew it, but they called it a name and they told us many beautiful things about it. And what are the beautiful things about this? So, class SK. Okay, first of all, it's conformal. A very beautiful thing is that it's an orbifold of class S, of theories of class S. Another very important thing is that the theories are labeled by punctured Riemann spheres. Okay, RS is Riemann sphere right now.
Sphere or surface?
Surface, it will be forever. Of course, the examples that I will give today will be only spheres, but it will be fine to generalize. And then, maybe the absolutely most important thing for me, and again, this is because my education was twisted from the beginning, is that they were able to show that the index, the superconformal index, can be written as some 2D topological field theory correlation. And of course, yes, the moment I saw this, and of course also this, there is only one question to ask. Can I do the other things we have learned for n equal to 2 theories? Do they go through? This is the first example of a 2D4T relation. Can I have more? So here is the plan to attack this question. Okay, first of all, for this talk, I will give first an introduction to SK. So a little bit a review from the original David Razamat paper and the way I like to understand it. The second part will be to learn how to calculate cyber-Witten curves or implicator cyber curves for a class S. And from them, and I will already start thinking about AGT, I will try to explain to you how I can, so from the curves, how I can read off the 2D algebra plus the representations of the would-be, if it exists, 2D CFT that would do this type of job for me. So, algebra and representations. And of course, the moment you have the algebra and the representations, Nobody can stop you from writing down the 2D conformal blocks that they should, if AGP is to exist, the instant convolution function of the SK theories. And I think more or less the talk will end here, but let me, in order to complete the picture, let me mention that, first of all, what you have to do is you have a proposal and you want to check if AGTK really exists. So you, one thing to do is to really try to calculate the instantons. So with Tom, we are actually calculating the instantons using the zero brains and the HANA limited picture. I have to say that our Italian Torino friend has basically, I think, calculated the same thing. I hope they will tell me the answer after using the string theory techniques at the early days of ADCFT. I just could never really find the final formula that I wanted in order to be able to compare. So we are really doing it from the Hanani Witten.
Sorry, I am a little ignorant. So what is
I will explain, and if I don't manage, we can, yes. And the final
So the problem is that Nekrasov
doesn't exist for any one. I mean, okay, I have to say that Nekrasov now has this origami business, and that might be another very beautiful way to get the same result. I just thought, and this is again the twisted education of the index, there is a way to map the calculation of Nekrasov partition function to a two-dimensional index calculation, and this is what I learned from the beginning, so I thought it was the easiest way to do it. But maybe it's not the easiest way to do it. And the final thing is that the moment you have 2D blocks, you can write down crossing, and you can ask the question, what is the three-point function for the 2D CFT you are looking for? From the original AGT, and I will review this at some point, the three-point functions of three trinions give you the three-point function. So nobody can stop me from calculating the partition function for a three trinion on S4 or on the squashed sphere, and this should better be a solution of a crossing equation. So if I can finally do this, I have proved that AGTK exists. And actually, if I can also say that it doesn't exist, it doesn't appear. So it's a yes or a no answer. And this is why it's very nice. So let's go for it. Any questions now that I am raising so that we can fill the time? So I want to introduce slowly
How crossing acts on this quantity should be related to how S-duality acts, no?
Of course.
So wouldn't be checking basically S-duality for this?
Yes and no. I mean, okay, yes is the answer, but okay, good. You have to write it in a way that you can check it basically.
Mm-hmm. Sure, it's very hard. Yeah.
Yes.
Is there an ambiguity on S4 and on flat space?
We go here now, you want to go?
The point 6, the correlation function, the partition function.
Already from n equal to 2 theories we know is ambiguities, but we also know how to take care of them for n equal to 2 theories. And I really, first of all, This is a universal formula, so no problem. But on the top of that, and here is a little bit why I wrote this word orbifolds so many times, I really expect that because we get these theories from orbifolds, that there will not be so much ambiguity. But we can talk more about this. So, I will introduce classes and escape on one go. So, Gaiotto told us that we should put n M5 brains on a 4-manifold times a Riemann surface with G genus and N punctures. And if we conceptually think that we do a Kaluza-Klein reduction on the Riemann surface, we get a 4D equal to 2 theory that is labeled by G and N and has as UN color factors. Of course, this story can be generalized for any A, D, or E. And on the other hand, here I can do Kaluza-Klein reduction on X4. Cordova and Jaffex have a very nice paper doing this precise thing. And here you get your 2D theory or observable on the Riemann surface. Now, on this construction, I want to do a transverse orbifold in the directions that where the M5s do not live, and I want to do it in such a way so that it preserves n equal to 1, and it preserves half supersymmetry. And of course, and this by definition is going to give class SK. Of course, instead of doing this, you could do a D or an E or default, but I'm not going to talk about this, but it should be a straightforward generalization. And then you would get what Waffa calls class S gamma. And that's a very large class of theories. Now, because also we have a very diverse audience, I want to give the presentation of what these theories are in a few different ways so that everybody can relate to it and connect to it. So, my favorite one, the one that I relate the most, is the Hanani-Witten construction. Let's first begin with class S. So, we put the D4s in this direction, and then D5s from 1 to 5, from 0 to 5. Let me also draw how this looks. Okay, here I will make an example for two D4 brains. So all of these guys, they are D4s. And these are NS5s.
For the experts, I'm very sorry to bore you.
This is a very nice place to start because you can first of all immediately see that rotations on 4 and 5 give us the n equal to 1, the U1 at symmetry of n equal to 2, and rotations on 7, 8, and 9 is the SU2 at symmetry. And you can also do a very fast supersymmetry counting. First, you put, for example, the D5s, and you break the 32 supercharges of type 2B down to 16. Then you should also impose that you have the D4s, so you break it down to n equal to 2 in 4 dimensions. And now I am very ready to further break supersymmetry and go down to n equal to 1 as k class. And this I will do by putting, hopefully, will fit a little bit, in my table the way the orbifold acts. So the orbifold will act on 4 and 5, and on 7 and 8. First of all, here you can immediately see that I break as U2 are symmetric down to some U1, and this will be the non-anomalous asymmetry of the n equal to 1 theories that I will have in classes K. Okay, how you break supersymmetry, also you have another relation like this. And then you get down to n equal to 1 supersymmetry. And now, what happens to this picture? I have it here because it's very hard to draw. So, I have to imagine that I put, so the, here I do a Z2 orbifold because it's very easy to draw. And I really should think that I am putting basically a mirror somewhere in the middle of this construction. And by putting a mirror, you then have to draw all the images of each D4 plane. And these are the ones that are supposed to be dust that I erased with my finger.
Sorry.
So, this is a 1D4, and here I draw its mirror image, and I do this for all of them. So basically this is how the class SK theories look in a Hanani-Witten description. Now, one thing to pay attention to, in principle, I should now study the Higgs branch of these theories, and in order to do that, I have to tell you what happens here. But I am not going to do that. I will put everything at the 0 of 7, 8, and 9 so that I don't have to study the Higgs branch and I don't have to make my life hard. If this project finishes at some point, then the Higgs branch would be a very natural... but now no Higgs branch is allowed.
Yeah.
I am sorry.
the thing is that...
So, I want to say that there is, yes. Let's continue a little bit more.
What does that, how do you invariantly distinguish that? I mean,
So let me say for now that my definition for the whatever branch it is that I'm looking at, I impose that everything I put, it has to be on this. This is the definition of my branch. This I can always do. Yes.
In this case, your Coulomb branch, which has massless vector multiplets on it.
Right.
So there's...
Yeah, there's an invariant distinction. That distinction between massless vector multiplets and massless chiral multiplets, sure, right? But I mean, so it's just the Higgs branch, the thing without vector multiplets. Is that what you mean?
There could be chiral relations, which will also mean mixing with other vectors.
So there will be chiral living relations, absolutely, but the relations will separate the operators that I will call Coulomb branch operators, and they will not mix with the ones that I will call Higgs branch.
So
they will be separate.
And is this an assumption?
It's not an assumption. You can classically absolutely do it, and of course quantum mechanically there is more work to do, but I think it's very consistent. Yes?
No, maybe it was possible in the conservation of the fact that in the n equal 2 case, you have a mesh 2 cross U1 asymmetry.
Yes.
Here you have two U1 symmetries coming.
one that is here with the 4-5, I will call it Coulomb branch, and the ones that are related with this U1, I will call it Higgs branch.
Yeah, so
and that's it, basically. That's my definition.
Let's
continue, because I will also say a little bit more from the Lagrangian point of view, so maybe there will become even more obvious. So the guys that will be charged under this one will be the Coulomb branch, for noise more than none. Okay, now, I will do the type 2B description very fast, so that we can connect maybe so with the orbital and yes.
So all your theories will have distinguished you on the plane.
I mean, which flavor should I pick?
Well, you have
this
U1. This is one combination of
these. I will have much more than one U1, and we will come in a moment.
Sure. The theories in this class are just.
Yes.
We'll
then we have at least this.
Yes.
So, from the type to B, of course, you can do a bit duality along X6, and you can write it like this. Here you can see what we are doing very nicely. First, we do an orbifold that acts on 6, 7, 8, 9. And this is the usual orbifold that breaks n equal to 4 down to n equal to 2. And then I do a further orbifold that will take me down to the n equal to 1. And this is precisely the theory you started 10 years ago. So this is an n equal to 1 orbifold daughter of n equal to 4. And people really started this theory more than 10 years ago. And we know the ADS dual for these theories. We know that when the coupling constants of all the color factors are equal, these theories are integrable. There are also integrable subsectors when you make some coupling constants to not be equal, and they have a way to calculate the instances for these theories. So this is very good. The equivalent of Nekrasov partition function.
Okay. Is that defined with this amount of symmetry?
Sorry?
Is it defined with this amount of symmetry, the omega background?
Instantons are objects that exist for zero supersymmetry. Now, if you can calculate the partition function or not, that's your own problem, right? But it's a very well-defined question.
Okay, but which background are you talking about?
What I would like to do is that I would like to have something equivalent to the omega deformation of Nekrasov. Of course, this is something hard, but these theories are also very special.
Right.
So. And in fact, I will underline this beautiful U1. That
so
I
having a distinguished U1 will be very important for this physical.
So now let me give a field theory description. And how do we do this? So we can begin with class S. Okay, these are just data collection theories. Of course, you can take your strong coupling limits and start getting Tn and whatever else you like. But let's begin with this, class S theories, n equal to 2. And I want to do an orbifold following Douglas and Moore. So let's just for fun a little bit write the superpotential. If this is C, plus 1, the superpotential in class S, it will look like Q. And I want to begin with this Lagrangian and orbi fold, and of course I know how to do that. Phi will be the field that in n equal to 2 was in the n equal to 2 vector multiplet, and it is charged under this U1R symmetry, so 4 and 5 rotations. So I know what happens to it, I act with the orbi fold on it. So what is going to happen to my phi is that I will have to identify it with. Okay, and then Douglas and Moore tells you that you have to define also a guy. So you begin with, this is a Kn by Kn matrix now. You have to define your projector. And more, you write everything, Kn columns. And you act in such a way, and you see that what is left, you make this identification, is just a guy that will have zeros in the diagonal, phi 1, phi 2, phi k minus 1, phi k. First of all, already this is very, very important, what I'm writing here. My adjoint phi became bifundamental, and now if I want to make global type of operators that will parameterize my Coulomb branch, I have to really put them all together in order to be able to take the trace. So now, the thing that I will call Coulomb branch will be operators that they will have to, because there's no other way, look like this, if I want to be able to trace. So this is by the definition of my Coulomb branch. And then, of course, there is the Q and the Q tilde. So these are the guys in fancy Dolan-Osborne notation that they descend from the E. And what about the Qs? You also? Yes.
The little phi's are n by n?
Sorry?
The little phi's are n by n.
The little phi's, they have to be n by n, and this is kn by kn. And for the Qs, you do the same. Okay, it so happens that on this guy, you can say that he comes from 7 and 8. Overfold acts the other way, and you have the non-zero components here, and this guy you can take to be diagonal. And then you just take this, you plug it in your Lagrangian, and you have your Lagrangian, and I need some strong man. They tell you how the bifundamentals are charged. The important things to say is that how do we now read off the superpotentials? We have to go here and look at the little triangles. And by looking at this picture, we can see that we have actually a lot of global symmetries. So all of these lines that I tried to draw nicely, it's not the best, but it will never have color, okay? So there are a bunch of U1s that I can actually allow my fields to be charged. So these are called gamma convention, these are called beta, and there are also some other U1s for which I get when I go up. And this is a full list of how all of these fields are charged. And all in all, when I look at this table long enough, I realize, and then you have to do also an anomaly calculation to convince yourself that these are anomaly free. You have k minus 1 u1s in the end of the day that will survive on the way. Yes?
Sorry, so this is the word one k3 on d4?
No, the...
Or is it the...
Yes, engineer? Yes, yes. In the Hanami rhythm,
yeah.
Is the theory that lives here, yes. In the type 2B, I just erased. Yes. But this is just the gauge theory construction, what I gave you.
So in those two cases, one, you're counting also the relative U1R minus the other U1R?
Yes, sure. In this one, I have counted this, now I can do it as another global symmetry. And this is the total of global symmetries plus my U1R symmetry. Yes.
So what do you say? Computing instantons? Or you compute instantons in those theories?
Yes. You compute the Lagrangian and you go.
So you compute the Microsoft partial function in those theories?
Yes.
So there is a the total of k plus n plus the greatest common divisor of k and n. A U1 field, which follows
from the table.
Yeah, but what would be what was the dependence on the n?
Which n?
The one you started from.
So all these fields, n capital N.
Yeah.
Are n by n matrices?
No, not the number of numbers.
M.
M, okay, yes.
M is the number of n5 rays.
Yeah.
So M, what it does, it's actually here. So it makes you draw more in this direction.
No.
So here, I should just sum.
It's the number of the dots.
That's confusing, right? So the one symmetry is associated with one puncture, right? So
yes.
If you have more punctures, having more n5 rings, so that number of global symmetries should be n.
Wait, he's right. But wait, now I'm not counting human punctures, right? Now I'm only counting global symmetries as I see them from this Lagrangian. So maybe some linear combinations here will have to be translated to the U1s I like, but I haven't said anything like that yet.
So what is the total symmetry of this theory?
This is the total symmetry,
yes.
Plus the flavor symmetry, which is for each box. So I have k copies of SUN flavor, so for each box. Sorry?
Why do you say SUN and not UN?
UN. Yes, sorry, I am used to.
Now is the dependence of N and stuff.
Yes.
However,
yes.
N.
What did I do?
N.
N. N. N is this box.
And you have N copies of it.
Yes. K.
So the number of U1s is N.
Okay.
Right?
No. So here,
okay.
Here I have k copies of UN from the left. I have another k copies if I go here from the right. And the ones that you want are actually, because this is what you get when you cross an S5, they are going to be relative U1s as I propagate through my quiver. And they will more be related with these U1s. So, but this is my total symmetry. This from the left, and another same from the right.
So that looks like any U1 punctures will have a
Sorry?
adding the one function should not change the rules.
It will not change the global subtree. It will not. It will be a linear combination of whatever is written there, the new ones.
But you cannot have more than.
But let's wait. Let's wait. Should I continue?
GCD.
What is GCD?
Greatest Common Divisor.
Yes.
This is an omnifold, which is a product of two discrete groups, and they are completely symmetric. So but there are several more in one direction, which are proportional to the greatest Common Divisor.
So the U ones that I know of are the ones I wrote there, which come from the beta, the gamma, and the alpha. And I don't know if there are more, I just don't know of them, but I don't think there are more. But maybe I'm wrong. Well, this is already a lot.
Depends on K, how large K is.
Sure.
Is it compact in one direction?
By the way, sorry, for k is equal to 1, I have an extra u1, which is correct.
Wait, it's not correct, it's because if k equals 1, and you can have n functions, and you should have u1 to the n.
I think this is a
so it is either
confusing way of counting, to be honest. Because when you make an orbifold, the puncture, so when you have your H5 range, and you have here N Weibull symmetry, and then you propagate and you compare with here, what's the U1 that you're referring to? Is the sum of all the A's to the left, is the mass of the bifundamental, and it's the sum of all the A's to the left, minus the sum of all the A's from to the right, maybe divided by 2 or by N. So, but you see, this is encoded in the
UX. That doesn't matter. I'm just counting the number of U1s, right? The number of U1s should match whatever you choose.
So, the way I would count these U1s, I would count them as coming from the relative center of masses of the stack of different brains. That's how I would count them.
So that does.
Let's continue. So now. Yes.
Do you use the intuition for why it's not symmetric?
What do I say?
Why is not symmetric on KRM?
Why it is not symmetric? By construction. So, first of all, in the PQ web symmetry, in order to make it symmetric, I would need to uplift to 5 dimensions. If I uplift to 5 dimensions, the picture is not going to look as beautiful as this. If you look where this orbifold is, I will in fact need to have NS5 brains that are not all parallel. So I will not have a two-dimensional beautiful picture, basically, in 5 dimensions anymore. That's the answer to this question. And it would be very nice to try to do something like that. Good. So now I want to calculate Chebbiwit and Kerzi. And all of the parameters and all the counting will be encoded on them, so there will be no problem. We can complain afterwards. Right? Yes.
What are they good for?
What are they good for?
Yeah, you cannot extract masses at big states.
I can calculate, for example, Kaplan constants. Do you like this?
There's still the low energy protected.
Yes. So we calculate the coupling so constant the in front of W alpha W alpha. That's where they will go.
You remove it, so.
Yes. So, okay, very beautiful. We have already here the picture. And basically what happens when you go to M-theory, both the NS5s and the D4, they uplift to one.
Why do you laugh? Okay. Of this form. Here I didn't write anything before. What I should have done is that the positions of the deformed brains, they label, they are the mass parameters, the Coulomb branch. Classically, these are the positions of the color brains, they are the Coulomb moduli parameters, and also another piece of the dictionary is that this distance between the NS5 brains is the Young-Mills coupling constant.
So here you're not considering the located NS5, right?
No. And also, very good, I mean, I don't know. This thing also, I mean, Ami, they wrote a paper after the regulator as a math where they also did this. And you were not in this paper, no. Marios, no. With Marios, right?
Yes.
So I'm not doing that. And for their case, the Weaver also looks a little bit different. So I'm not going to do that. But I think that everything that I will write from now on, in fact, you can also do it for this case.
Yeah, the reason I'm asking is that it's relatively hard to write a curve.
We then did it in 97. So if you did it in 97, we can copy this paper. You believe? I mean, it's not easy. Yes. So this, basically, the answer of Witten back from 97 is that this shape, this curve, is the Cyber-Witten curve. That lets you know it as MT. So okay, I have not defined anything. I'm afraid. I follow my notes. So I denote one holomorphic variable V as X4 plus IX5, and this is the guy that keeps track of the U1, which is related to the thighs of n equal to 2. First I will do n equal to 2, and then we will do the orbifold. And I need one more. Let's first define S, which will be the X6 plus IX10. X10 is the M-theory direction, now that I am uplifting. And X6 is the position where I have... So here I can write that I'm calculating with SS. And now, instead of having 1 over G squared, I will have tau. And it's also very useful. Just copy Witten and define, maybe you can put also the third circle, but I will not really keep track of this. So then, all in all, I will have here T, and here I will be measuring V. So this is going to be my curve. In a minute, I will make an example, and the moment I have this, at least for n equal to 2 theories, I can define my Cyber-Witten differential in these coordinates that I just introduced by thinking about the VPS particles that I cannot calculate, at least in principle for now.
I want to calculate the mass of the BPS particles. I'm doing n equal to 2. And what I have to do is that I have to imagine that I insert M2 grains that end on the D5. For example, I can make a picture here. So the M2s will be point particles because I want to describe my BPS, so there will be a trajectory on 0, 1, 2, 3. And then I am left with a disk with two more. So I have to do this type of integrals, and in order to do them, I need a holomorphic 2 form. So I have to have a holomorphic 2 form for V and S. So omega will be. And this is going to define my Scheibler-Witten differential as I have no way to argue that I can calculate the BPS particles for now, but I will use my BPS, my Scheibler-Witten differential naively from now on.
Also, it's going to be used to more than just
just to calculate integrals around different cycles. I will just call them A and A dual, and I will close my eyes for now. Should we stop here, or should I make an example?
No, well, it's up to you. Whenever you
but
think.
If I start writing, maybe it's not so nice.
Whenever you think it's better to
maybe,
stop.
Let's maybe stop now.
Yes.
Okay, good. So now we in principle know how to compute Scheibler-Witten curves. Let's compute first one example for n equal to 2, and then we will move to n equal to 1. Here is the simple n equal to 2 example, which will be SU2 with 4 flavors. So great. Okay, I am leaving. Maybe I don't need to make the picture again. The important thing is that the masses are here. And also another thing that I said is that the distance between the S5 grains is 1 over Gian Wills in the X6 coordinates, or tau when I have a full holomorphic S, or Q when I go to the exponentiated, and in fact let me just pick to put at T1 this and S5 brain, and at T equal to Q this one. And I mean, look at here the arrow, so infinity is here, right? And T equal to 0 is from here. So how do we do this? It's very simple. We will impose that we have a surface that so I want to find an equation that has zeros when I meet the end of this branch. So first of all, let's consider this curve as a polynomial in V. So I have to write something like this. Here I'm not writing yet what I want. So I want to write something that for V very large, so very much up or very much down, it has zeros at 1 and 2. So that's it, and I don't know what is this. And now I want to view it the other way around. I want to write something. Okay, here I don't have the parentheses. That will have zeros. First, let's do t going to infinity. So I have to go here. So I need to have a zero at m1 and m2. Oops, minus. Let me not say yet what is here. And what do I put here? When v goes to zero, so when t goes to zero, I need m3 and m4. So then I look upstairs. Basically, I'm done. I have done all the job that I had to do. First, let's see what happens with v squared. I need to put a q here. And what do I need to put here? First, v squared. I need to put. And now I also need to decide what to do with the constant term and this. It's like work. You can convince yourself that this is. The sum of all the masses. And here remains an unknown constant, that's the only constant I couldn't fix. And this unknown constant that remains is going to be identified with the Coulomb moduli. Either by comparing with the original Sender-Witten curve, or by starting doing integrals and starting convincing yourself that this should be the case. Or by studying also the weak coupling limit. You pick your way. So this is the Sender-Witten curve for SU2 with four flavors. Here I gave you the Sender-Witten differential. So you can calculate everything you like. Now let's do the same for the SK class. And we have this nice picture here. So basically we just repeat what we did there, but for this case. It's almost silly, it's really the same.
So in the n equals 2 case, a little bit more work, you can do the conformal case with the masses.
So this is the conformal case.
No, this is the case with the masses turned on.
You set the masses to zero and you are done. In this case.
No. I mean, you need, there appears a new parameter, which is the UV gauge coupling, right?
The UV gauge coupling is Q.
It's Q here.
So Q is equal to E to the 2 pi I, okay, some notation, tau UV.
So I can't have both. I mean, in the massive case, there's just the dimensional scale.
You can have both, yes.
Fixed masses, then there's still a
coupling constant. Of course, if I calculate tau IR, it is going to be a function of all the masses.
Oh, okay.
And
I see.
Right.
Okay. I see.
But, Okay, good. So now, and by the way, okay, of course, because I didn't want to have to write, I just did this very little example, but I can add as many before breaks as I like, as many NS5s, and the same thing, just longer. Now, I have to look at this picture, and I have to put my zeros. Okay, let's do it immediately for any case. So what will happen here, I have a mirror, and I double my defaults. When I do for any k, I have roots of unity, so I will have something like a circle. So what will happen here is that I will eventually be able to write everything in this way. So this is really immediate. And already let me make a comment that maybe I should have made. I will make it here. So you see here, I have only one coupling constant. So from the Hanani-Witten description of the SK class, I don't know how to create more coupling constants. So I don't know from the quiver for each different image how to allow it to have different ones. I would have to do some T-duality and go to some other description to do that. So here, all QIs, they are equal to 2, and this is the so-called orbital point.
You have the collection of T1s, no?
Sorry?
T1s.
What are the T1s?
In your singularity. There is a singularity, there are vanishing T1s.
Very good. But that I need to go to whatever subtype to be or some other description. With this very beautiful geometric picture, I don't know how to do it. Maybe you can tell me.
It won't be geometric, there will be moduli which are not geometric.
Okay, yes, then fine. Yes.
There are B-fields.
Yes, exactly. Okay, good. So now I have the orbital point and they are all equal to each other. Great, and now I need to tell you what this is. And this again raises a discussion with the long branch. So this is the answer for what is P of B. This is the answer that respects the orbifold without having without having the use having charge under this beta and gamma U1s. So this is for me another definition of the Colombo branch, if you wish. And these U's, they will be the operators that I had there, the orbifolded projections of E to the R. So this U K is going to be the trace of phi 1 lambda phi k, and the u 2 k is going to be the trace of this guy squared. And this is my definition of the Coulomb branch. So I really don't allow for anything else. And this is captured here. Good. No complaints, so I move on. Very good. It's all down here from now. I am not going to show any calculation. I just wanted to make the point that we know how to write down curves. And here is an example, and you can add more NS5s, you can add more defaults, and you can play the game, and you can write curves for these theories. You can check what happens in a strong coupling, you can do weak coupling, you can do whatever you like. Now, because I want to start making contact, I want to go to the HD direction, I want to go to something that's called Gaiotto, or UV curve. And this is where the story of Gaiotto started. So I will do a rewriting. I want to change coordinates. Okay, this is a little bit silly, but let me write it anyway. And bring my curves in this form. And I will immediately go now to any n. So any number of
Let me even do this, which is related with how many N5 brains are going to have. And here I should have. So I claim that I can bring all of these types of curves always to this form. And let me give first an example for N equal to 4. In a moment, it will be absolutely clear what this thing is. So I'm sorry, little slight notation here. So what is this gadget? This is something that I should draw on a four-punctured sphere. Here is my t equal to zero. Here is my t equal to infinity. T equal to one. T equal to q. And already now this is calling for definitions. But before we do that, let's do first the weak coupling limit, so that I can also write one more, just because it's very useful. By the way, I should have written and I will write now. What is this C? This C is the Casimirs combinations for the masses. By the way, if I go here and I set k is equal to 1, the result that I have is the n equal to 2 result we know from Gaiotto. Up to one thing, Gaiotto would do an extra shift on V. Let me maybe write it. Gaiotto would do this. V1 is what I wrote before. And in his notation, for any is this true, but the for example, let's look at this. It will look like the power is becoming like this. What is M left and M right? Is the sum of all the masses from the left, and the same for R. But now, what is going on? Now when I'm just naively summing, I get zero, because I have m times e to the 2 pi I integer divided by k, and when I sum this, I get zero. So for us, this is zero. So now what is happening? I can interpret this full puncture as an object that carries all the information about n. So first of all, it comes with this power and has all the information these mass parameters, and what happens is that on the simple puncture, you can see what happens here. The sum is zero, so the simple punctures
they look like they carry no parameter. Or another way to say it is that if you would write here k to the n, you get zero, there is nothing. You only get, if you move down to poles, only something that would be a simple pole, and all it has on it is some type of balancing condition that is left over from what is on the left and what is on the right. Very good. So this is the new simple puncture and full puncture. And if there's no question on this, I will move on to review ATP. Okay, yes, please.
Is there some sort of generalization of the engine system?
In principle, I can tell you that this is the definition of a kitchen system. You tell me what it is, right? So this, I give you a curve. I can say that this is the definition of a kitchen system. I think it should be acceptable, what I say. Maybe you don't like it. Okay, there is a way. Okay, I am not going to talk about this, but there is a way to think that you construct your kitchen system beginning from 10 dimensions or 6, so you can really follow this path here.
And I'm just asking if there's some simple way to say how to generalize these issues equations.
So the way I am doing it, because I am telling that I don't know your long branch, is basically trivial. It's the same one that you know. If you want to include the cubes, there is a little bit of work there. But let's talk after about this. You can do it, but I mean, it will become ugly.
So really, this is all at the OB4 point, right?
Yes. I know how to derive curves away from the orbifold, you can repeat basically everything that I will say in the fully general Vigito Schreiber curve and see what you get. Actually, things are very similar.
So, is it still true that these are spectral curves in some sense?
Yes.
I guess that's another way of asking the question.
Yes.
Yeah, it's like we have some
yes.
Yes. Some system. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, nice. So now that the number is not here, I can find his here. I will review ATP very fast. I am very sorry. So that everybody is in the same page. Is a relation between 4D equal to 2 theories plus S that are labeled by Riemann surface with G genus and M punctures. And let me just write in order to be nice. You can think for now, let's do only SUN case. You can think that you have SU2 or SUN. Why do I make this distinction? So that below I can write all total. And let's write things in a way so that what is this correspondence is immediately obvious. And you will not start seeing your papers now, but okay, you have to forgive me. And now immediately the translation.
So I can, AGT says that there is an endpoint function of the X operators, alpha can be in UV, just one single parameter. If I am in total, these are vectors. And I decompose this into three-point functions according to the bootstrap. So I can write, let's say, alpha 1, alpha 2. There is some internal momentum that flows. Other external guys. In here, what I will have blocks. But they will be functions of the internal momenta that I have to integrate over and the external momenta, alpha I. And, of course, of some cross ratios of the Z's that I immediately call Q. And, of course, the central charge of the field. So, let's really review the correspondence. So, the instant of partition function is very clear from what I'm writing. It has to be equal, and it is, to the blocks. In order for this to happen, look at what's happening here. We are integrating over the Coulomb moduli, so they have to be identified with the momentum that is flowing internally. And in fact, because A's, they have dimension of mass, you should really divide and write this relation. The same thing you have to do with the masses that are not integrated over, and you should identify them with the external momenta of the vertex operators. The Q's are really the cross ratios. And there is one thing that I didn't tell you what it is. Is here written as C, the central charge, and here have the omega background. So, and in UV or in TOTA, I have not only the central charge, but the B, the coupling constant. And of course, there is the 1 over B that is an inverse of that. And Q, which is a combination that gives the central charge finally. I will write it like this. So, any other questions?
I think the little momentum of the vertex operators is really shifting with respect to the mass parameters.
Yes, but I'm not going to write. Yes, yes, yes. So, depending on which precise n for TODA, the way you shift is a little bit different. So, let's do this. So, let's write here. There you go. Plus some epsilons in the appropriate way because it's different for any n and I don't want to do it. And for example, for the wheel, the central charge is like this. And then for TODA, for W3, you have here a 2 and here a 24, and then you change. So, but I don't care about, I don't want to write it down.
It's just three times the bound vector.
Yes, 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 yes. Great. So, now that I have AGT, I don't want to do it because I don't have any of the elements here for now. Don't have them. Let me do something else. Let me try to discover AGT from the chemist.
Can I just ask before you do that? Do you expect it to exist in the sense?
Yes.
I mean, what's the
AGT? I bet my money on it.
Did you define for Philadelphia what you mean by the next software?
I mean, we said that it should be for this quiver theory that I have in the back of the blackboard, whatever is the instant on partition function. And if you wish, let's phrase it in a better way. This is something that comes out of the localization of Pestum. I absolutely expect, and in fact I'm doing it, this is one of the things I'm working on now, that you should be able to do precisely the same thing for theories, for Lagrangian theories in classes K. So you should be able to localize and have a one of the determinants.
But I would have thought, for example, if you just have a U1R symmetry, just a U1R symmetry, right?
Yes.
So I would have thought perhaps you could only turn on most of the parameters in a single plane.
Sure, there are a lot of conceptual problems, but...
Okay, that's not concept, that's just the point of the matter.
Okay, good. I think that all of these problems can be overcome. And I can tell you after more about this.
Yes, because of your shooter experiment more.
Yes.
I will step out a little bit.
So let's try to discover AGT from the curves, and of course one little thing, in order to get the curves, you really start from Lakashov, and you have to take the limit that the omega deformation should just go to zero. Ask me better, because if we are talking about something. Sorry. So I take the omega background now that we don't like it to zero. And great. Now, okay, let's remember 101 CFT class. What happens when we do? We take our favorite vertex operator and we do the OP with special energy tension. Well, we get here 2. And here we get the conformal dimension of it. And what is more, and this is again CFT 101, is if you take your favorite higher spin current, if there is such a guy, and you do here the OP with your favorite V, you will get here something that is in the power L, and this here will be the spin of your favorite V. And in fact, this formally can be written in word identities. Okay, let me write only the first one. Okay, I have to sum over all my friends here. H is H. So happens when you will, which is very nice, L minus 1 becomes just a liquid derivative. For the other life is harder, unfortunately. And here I have, so this is the word identity, CFT 101. And by looking at this, and looking at the curves that I had here before and I deleted them, you start seeing basically the pattern. The pattern is the following. First of all, the double pole. It has to be identified and these things. Okay, in the normalization that I'm having, you get the minus, but it doesn't matter. So you immediately see this equation. You only look at the higher poles. And then you can really go home and do an honest calculation. Let's first do it. For as you do, let's calculate the free premium. In fact, I wanted to write it down, but I think I never did. So the 3, 2, you really get, Chris. And then you go and you do for SUN, for the free premium, which is this. And here you have L now. So for all of them, and now you will really have to specify which guys you put in. These are really equal, only using this, nothing else. So, but now, this is what happens for n equal to 2. I will take these equations, and I will ask the question, what happens for sk? I have this part of the equation, what is the right-hand side? And nobody can stop me from doing this. And this will, by definition, give me an algebra, the conserved current of this 2D theory. And on the top of that, because of this type of relations, it will give me the representations. This is the point. In fact, I said it. If you want to make it a little bit more general, you can also do it for your fully interacting, for example, 4-point or 5-point or whatever thing you like. Of course, the calculation there becomes very fast, very hard, but you can do this. You can calculate the curve, we know how to do it. And this should really be equal to a conformal block. With the whatever current you have insertion at point Z divided by the block. And this is nice to call it like this. This weighted correlation function. So just by making this comparison, you can find the symmetry algebra and the representation. So for SK, we do it. And this is the answer. The 2D algebra that should underlie the AGTK is the WKN algebra. And this is really just a multiplication, nothing else. The representations are basically the WKN representations, but some special cases of them, not the most generic ones. And they are special, so the refs are. And with the parameters chosen such that they happen to be non-unitary. And the first moment you find something that's non-unitary, you worry, but then you remember that the chiral algebras are also non-unitary, so it's not a bad thing if it's in the 2D theory you get something that's non-unitary. And not only that, but every individual block, 3-point block, 4-point block, everything that you calculate, you can in fact immediately obtain it from the n equal to 2 friend simply by imposing the orbital condition. So, what's that? So, all blocks and representations are obtained by taking an SU KN block from the n equal to 2 case and substituting inside. So this is and precisely the same equation for the masses. I'm not going to write it. Yes. Sorry?
Maybe it's in line, but in the AGT, AGT computers, what happened when you made the four manifolds and you did the supermassive configuration?
Sorry?
AGT is kind of like the description. So it's kind of like the description. What you did when you make the manifold and you put the supermassive theory, the four manifold is common. So that would, yeah. So, well, the non-unitarity here, when did you try?
Non-unitarity of the quantum massive theory. He's saying, think of the 2D theory you're getting from AGT as putting it, taking the 1-0-60 theory on a small 4-manifold.
Mm-hmm.
And so, wouldn't you expect a unitary 2D theory?
So this non-unitarity, first of all, it's not related with the series that we are studying, it's related with the representations. So the representations are non-unitary. And it comes, I mean, okay, it's a very technical thing and I don't want to say. When you write the most general Verma module, you start questioning from things. And one of the things that we find is that this denot guy, he comes out to have h is equal to 0. But this guy, I mean, h is equal to 0 only one has. In a normal unitary theory, only the one has. So, but this, this cannot be because we know the three-point functions. So v naught cannot be 1 because if it would be, this would look like a two-point function. So this is not allowed. So from this is where the non-unitarity comes from.
So you're saying that the theory is unitary or
the theory itself, it's nothing. But then I study representation theory of that.
Nothing means unitary.
And the representation of V, of this simple function, is non-unitary.
But the theory does admit unitary representation.
The theory does admit non-unitary representation.
The ones that occur in this particular
yes.
setup are not.
Yes.
Also include non-unitary.
That's what it is. I don't think that this is a bad thing.
Well, so what that means is that when I tease apart the Nekrasov partition function, negative contributions to the sum.
Let's continue and we'll see what happens. Great. Yes, okay, let's do that. So something very nice happens. So this is what it is. And this is a very important thing. The original condition, of course, is exciting. And now, in order to go to Nekrasov, I need to turn on the omega background. Because remember, all of this and in fact, what this means is that, for example, Q is equal to 0.
So everything you just said is another.
Sorry?
Everything you just said is another.
Everything I said is for this.
But then the blocks diverge around the C.
So look what happened here. Here I am computing only weighted blocks and nothing diverges.
Okay.
Okay? Good.
Sorry. Do you know the Beer Thrust and Fridge?
Sorry?
What's the Beer Thrust and Fridge part?
Fantastic. I don't know. Because of this, I can never get from the curves C. So, let me write it.
So it's not like 1 plus 3q squared with q equals 0?
Sorry?
It's not some stupid formula like 1 plus 3q squared.
See, if you try to calculate these things,
yeah.
Precisely because you always do this type of replacement, plus q's, you always have to multiply it in places and it always cancels. So you do this calculation and you never learn anything about c.
So if I put, you know, the a fancier word I actually use, which involves the insertion of a pair of stress tensors into a correlation function divided by the correlation function, that, I mean, that's what c would appear.
Very good, yes,
but
the curves, look at them,
They carry only this information. The carriage.
So I can't study the insertion of two J's.
Not from the carriage. You would have to find another way.
Do you want the ratio of epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 to be fixed to something? Or do you not have in the limit where you go to epsilon 1 equal to 0 and epsilon 2 equal to 0, do you want to fix the ratio to be some number?
No. I just really want to go to 0. You will never find the ratio, you will find really no sign of anything like B. So B also, I don't know what it is. I don't. I plain don't.
It's a little hard, if you don't know what C is, it's a little hard to be talking about the representations of this double algebra. Since whether you're unitary or not depends on stuff like the value of C's.
So I only can tell things about epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 equal to 0. This is the fact of life. This is the only thing you can learn from Kervis. So the only thing that I know from Kervis is, for example, this type of things, and this for me defines the representation and a cheat. The same thing I can find in WLs and nothing else. So now I want to say something more. Right? I want to make a claim for the instanton. So, what I will do is the following. First of all, we have the reps. I will make an assumption. I will demand that the representations do not change when I turn on epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. And what I mean, and I'm right here in parentheses, the null vectors that define representations, they don't change, they are the same, in the same places, in the multiplet, in the same number precisely. When I turn on.
I'm very confused.
Yes.
So what the null vectors are, it's a function of H and C. You told me we don't know what C is, so I
yes,
know
we don't
know.
We don't know, but for simple cases, null vectors, there is some relations on the guy equal to zero. And these things here, these coefficients that define the null vectors, they are of this type of formulas. They are ratios
so
of different charges.
This is a level 1.
Yes, this is an example. And
no, but in general, like have null vectors at higher levels.
Yes.
Very hard to understand.
So, very good. But the most basic things, they are the simple puncture, which is precisely this guy. We already know this from equal to 2 thing. And the full punctures, they are guys with null vectors. So, and I am fine. As long as I can write down the ratio, I win. And I can write down the ratio with Q turned on or without. As long as this.
Okay, so.
So that's it, basically.
So, in a sense, you want to preserve the notion of the minimum.
What I want to do with
the notion of minimal punctures is
various. Of course, of course.
That's
in fact, all the representations. But, in, yes. So that's the game. So the moment I can do this, it absolutely makes sense to say
deal now with a block. Of course, now this thing will be a function of whatever all these guys. Some see that I don't know what it is, but this is parameterizing my omega background, and they choose the cross ratios, and of course the guy that runs in the middle. And the only thing that I don't know now is how precisely to turn on Q inside W. That's the only thing I don't know. Now, one more thing. If I assume that Q is turned on precisely in the n equal to 2 way, so if, for example, the conformal dimension, or I called it H before, is really like this, so before I had minus alpha squared, or for example, for the Liouville case, this is the way Q is turned on. If this is the case, the instant of partition function of these guys, but this is an if, this I cannot, you can really show that they are equal to the Nekrasov partition function that you know from n equal to 2 theories by making this substitution. So, let me write it. If this is true, then
this is a better one. So if you think in this H2 relation that you wrote for SK, that seems to be the same thing as just H2 relation for SUKN, for example.
Yes, this is what I'm saying.
What's the difference between that? Because then just choosing your Coulomb map to be that will not change your representation to be non-unitary.
For V naught, it will. For V naught, it will. Because for V naught, what is the H? Good, let's do it. What is the H for... it's the sum, you have to sum all the masses, right? So the simple function, the U1, you have to sum all the mass parameters. 2KN. But what is this now? This is equal to zero because of the orbital condition. This is what happens. This is whose fault is the non-unitary.
So this is not incorporated in Q, right? Because there's a shift of Q that will render it to
pH.
Sorry?
For the usual AGT, there's a shift by Q, so that actually ends up in pH.
Fantastic. This is the part that I don't know what will happen. This is precisely the part that I don't know. So, if I assume that I can then turn on Q the way I know, then you get the instant of partition function from class S, U, K, N, just with this A obeying this orbital condition that I wrote before. And the same thing for the masses. And basically, that's it. That's all I can say only with this. So, okay. Okay,
so
let me, yeah, sorry.
So now you want to plug this into the formula for the S4 partition function. Conjecture and expression for the S4 partition.
I mean, okay, I don't want to conjecture anything. I'm actually calculating.
Okay.
So, and, the only, if we, but this is not a conjecture, I tell you, if this is the truth, so there's not nothing
yeah,
yeah.
Else.
So this is for sure.
That's true, that's a conjecture, right?
No, but I don't want to claim that this is correct. No? Maybe this is wrong. What I claim is this. Basically, what I claim is that there is a notion of instantons, that's all.
Okay, but I like the S4 partition function because it's an observer.
Yes.
It's perhaps independent in an n equals 1 theory, but you just said that the third derivative with respect to the mass parameter is scheme independent. So I want to compute that thing because I know.
So very good. For this thing, you need one more thing, and what you need is the one loop determinant. Now, very good. And maybe I can wrap it up like this. So I need the one loop determinant. The one-loop determinant has for theories with the Lagrangian description, it has two contributions. One contribution for n equal to 2 theories is the hypermultiplet, and another contribution is the vector multiplet. The contribution of the hypermultiplet, you do not need any localization in order to calculate. For example, you can say I'm calculating the trinium, and you can always do the path integral because it's just x to the square, x to the square, this integral we know how to do, and you can do it, and we have done this. So I know for class SK what is the partition function for the free trinium. Now, in order to be completely done and consistent, you need to use this block, write down the crossing equation, and check that the partition function that I calculated for the free trinium is a solution for crossing. So there is no room for conjectures, it's either yes or no. But that I haven't finished doing yet. It's a little bit complicated and one has to be very careful. Okay, I can stop here. I mean, and you can ask me what you want.
So, is there just an independent way of checking this guess for the SK instanton?
So, with Tom, what we are doing now, we have an independent way that I can review a little bit if you want of calculating the instanton partition function using these zero brains. And this is going to provide a way to, in fact, tell what is this C. And in fact, for Toda, already in the what is the one instant of contribution, C already appears. So immediately, with one instanton. In fact, one instanton nobody can ever, one instanton you can do in a normal field in your favor, it's n equal to zero. So you can find C with the one instanton. So there is really no room for any conjecture here. Everything is completely fixed.
And what happens for the instanton?
Okay, so already, we have a machinery, let's say, that's calculating it, but it's a huge, ugly beast, so I cannot say anything yet. You have to wait a little more. It's very huge and ugly.
And how does it depend on supersymmetry?
What do you mean?
You said that for one instanton, the computation can be done independent of the amount of supersymmetry.
Yes. So the way we are doing it, we are of course using supersymmetry. We are computing some type of index. In fact, it's the bulk volume theory that lives on the D0 brains. Or there is a better way maybe to uplift to D2. And you compute some type of index, and this gives a beast. And from that, you can read off instant one by instant.
But you see, that computation depends on supersymmetry. That computation definitely depends on Susie.
Absolutely.
Why is that?
No, what I said is that you can calculate one instanton even for theories without supersymmetry. Nobody can ever stop you from doing this. If you know your quantum theory, just sit down and do it. That's all I said. I didn't say that.
It's clear that the pool from the partition function becomes a localized function. It's not a configuration. Is this step okay, or is it also different?
Okay, very good. A very naive answer is we absolutely don't know, right?
But I expect that it should localize on instantons. It should, that it should be the same thing. Okay, here, this I expect, it really comes from inheritance. So, at least for LabGen, back in 98, when ADCFT was invented, the orbifolds were invented and everything, and Vafa and his friends, they wrote a series of papers where they discussed this. So, if there is inheritance for LabGen, okay, I don't know, but I really think that it should be. These are very, very, very special theories, and that's why I made all of this introduction. I didn't pick a random equal to one theory.
Can you suppose that I have n equal to one theory? Maybe not in this class, but I know n equal to one curve. Can I run the machinery and copy?
If you know a curve?
I know n equal to one curve, but maybe not belong to class SK. Can I run the machinery?
So, I want to hope that you can. But let me just say one thing. Why this thing is so special? This thing is special because all the physics happens on the cyber, on the Hamani-Witten, basically it's a two-dimensional physics. Right? It's this picture. If you pick your favorite n equal to one theory, what happens? And because of this, the curve is one equation. If you pick your random n equal to one theory with a curve, Simone will tell you that it is not just one equation, it's many equations. And good luck with that. That's why this class is so nice. I mean, you don't have to really kind of be stupid and just do it.
For example, the Klebanov-Witten doesn't belong to this class.
Who?
Klebanov-Witten doesn't belong to this class. But
no, this would be the natural level of the field study. Would be nice. Or one of the also in other directions. So you in fact need a three-dimensional plot to make. Or you can think it like a two-dimensional thing with defects. So either you will want to have a theory with defects. Actually, it makes sense also, because n equal to 2 theories in 4D, they are n equal to 1 in 5D. And what is n equal to 1 in 4D? You have to put defects.
Well, let's thank you.